Welcome everyone to today's broadcast, where we'll be gaining insights on economic trends in India. Today's guest speaker is none other than an avid researcher, an economic professor in BML Manjul University. She comes with over 19 years of work experience in leading B schools and has obtained her PhD in economics with specialization in econometrics. She not only has presented her paper at Gender Work and Organization Conference at Sydney, but is also a member of the Editorial Review Board of International Journal of Emerging Markets. Along with this, she's also the recipient of two Best Paper Awards. Thank you, Dr. Sangeeta Datta Gupta, for joining us today on Brickwork Ratings Podcast.
Thank you, Tina, for inviting me.
So, ma'am, the impact of COVID-19 on India has been largely disruptive. It's not only a loss in human lives, but also in terms of economic activity. How did the pandemic impact the Indian economy and, more importantly, the rural economy?
Well, Tina, before I talk about how the pandemic impacted the Indian economy, let me take you back to the pre-pandemic days. What was the situation of the economy in the pre-pandemic days? Indian economy was not doing well even before the pandemic. Just before the pandemic, our GDP growth rate in nominal term was at 42-year low, lowest since 1978. And the real GDP growth at 5% was lowest in 2008-9. So the economy started slowing down since 2017-18 and showed this a contraction for three consecutive years, which is, since 1991-92, it has never happened before. And also, Indian economy is consumption-driven. 60% of the GDP comes from consumption. What we also found out that the average consumption expenditure per person per month in the rural areas fell from rupees 1587 to 1524. Same thing in the urban areas. So basically, consumption was falling, and the economy was in bad shape even before the pandemic. And the pandemic was, of course, a very big blow. We all know about nationwide lockdown last year. So during that time, there were job cuts, salary cuts. So it further reduced the consumption, and the economy contracted by close to 24%, 24.4% to be precise, in the first quarter. And in the entire financial year, the economy contracted by 7.3%. So the first wave actually hit the economy badly, and the second wave, the talk of the second wave, of course, it was more devastating in terms of a loss of lives. Our health infrastructure collapsed completely. But the response to second wave was localized, less stringent. So economy, the growth rate that we would have got without the second wave, that probably it impacted that as well. So the growth rate that we saw in the first quarter probably would have been more, maybe 25-26%, had the second wave not hit us so badly. So yes, both the first wave as well as the second wave impacted the Indian economy badly. As far as the rural economy is concerned, that's an interesting question, Tina. It's the impact on the rural economy. I think we have all seen, pictures of how the migrant workers are walking back to their home states. So that was kind of reverse migration. You know, many of these families, they are dependent on the income of the migrant workers, those who come, go to cities to work. So their income failed, their savings depleted, and they were unable to repay the loans. According to a report, even migrants' income actually fell by 85%. So that impacted the rural economy a lot. During the first wave, Corona did not enter the rural parts of the country, but in the second wave, it did. So yes, the rural economy was also impacted badly by the pandemic.
Right. I was just looking at the figures. So GDP has actually witnessed a growth of 20% in the first quarter of FY22. So what is your take on it? And do you think this is a V-shaped recovery for India?
Well, as I told you, probably without a second wave would have been 25-26%, now it's 20%. But to 20% is actually, you know, the base, it is coming against a very low base, because last year, during the first quarter, the economy contracted by 24.4%. So since the base is low, so you cannot actually call it a very good recovery. Of course, it is on the path to recovery, because if you compare it to the pre-pandemic first quarter, it's still down by 9.2%. In fact, it is less than the fourth quarter of last year as well. So, but I would not say it's a V-shaped recovery, definitely not. But it is on the path to recovery. The economy is on the path to recovery. Some have positive signs, you know, huge procurement of paddy in the rural areas, tractor sales went up, that is rural demand is going up. Then, of course, a few other things, like if you look at the core sectors, except crude oil and refinery product, most of them have surpassed their pre-pandemic level. Even IIP or PMI, they're also doing robust trend. So yes, it's on the path to recovery, but I would not say that it has completely recovered, gone back to the pre-pandemic days, and it's actually a V-shaped recovery. I think quarter to quarter it's changing. So maybe a W-shaped, whatever you call it, but definitely I don't think it's a V-shaped recovery. And this 20% is also, you know, it's very deceiving, because you just look at the 20%, but you have to compare it with the base also. If the base is low, probably that 20% will not, it's not 20% coming against a high base. That would have been great. It's a 20% coming against a very low base. So probably that's where the problem lies.
Right. Okay. So that's against a low base, and the economy is on the path of recovery. But there has been much talk on a third wave. So what, according to you, will be the impact of a third wave if and when it arises on the economy?
Well, third wave, you know, I think in Kerala's cases have started increasing again. So maybe third wave will come, but probably the scale of it will be, less compared to the second wave. But I feel the impact on the economy will be limited, because, during the second wave also, what we saw that it was a state, it was led by the states. They were taking the decision regarding the lockdowns. It was less stringent, more localized. And now people are vaccinated also. So they are, they're more confident, they're vaccinated. Of course, there are concerns about the Delta variant, about third wave. But I believe that the impact will be limited. And the sectors which have been doing well, the manufacturing, mining, or the agriculture will continue to do well. Some sectors like travel and tourism, which were impacted badly, will continue to have a weak, will continue to remain weak for some more months. But what my feeling is that probably the impact will not be that huge. It will be limited. And because we are now, probably we know how to face it after the second wave. And the fact that most of us will be vaccinated, we are getting vaccinated, that is also a plus point, I guess.
That's true. I think now we all know how to deal with it. So all the sectors are moving with COVID or without.
Yes, this tracking and, tracking, checking, the testing should continue. And all of us should, which we are not actually, should follow that COVID appropriate behavior, which is very, very important. If you follow that, I think we'll be able to win the battle against COVID.
Right. So I think the government is also taking a lot of measures as well. But is there any measures that you can suggest that the government can adopt to revive the economy as such, so that it can become something like a pre-pandemic level?
Well, I think they are taking a number of steps. But what would I have liked, as I told you, it's a consumption-driven economy. Probably because the GST is very robust. So government can use that to increase fiscal stimulus, because we need money so that demand can go up in our hands. So that is one thing. Unemployment support, of course, is required. Another thing which we usually do not talk about is that women actually were affected more than men. Any kind of health emergency, impact women more than men. And this was no exception. In fact, there was this gender parity report which showed that, it would have taken 257 years to get parity in economic participation between men and women. and it has increased to 267 years in 2021. It was 2022, it was 257. So the gap between men and women in terms of economic parity and economic participation only increased. And also, as per the United Nations report, for every 100 men, 118 women are in poverty. So any kind of unemployment supports to take into consideration women also. I think some steps government already took in terms of national infrastructure pipeline, national monetization pipeline. I think those are steps in the right direction. And the CapEx expenditure went up by 35%, but it could not be spent in the first quarter. So government should ensure that it is spent. And these are the steps they can take. Some steps they've already taken, but some other steps like, take into consideration that women need to be supported as well because they have been impacted adversely. And then fiscal stimulus. These are a few things which government can do. Hopefully by end of next year or maybe next to next year, we'll be able to, go back to our pre-pandemic days. Maybe next year, I'm hoping for next year only. And yes, we'll be on the path to recovery.
Okay, ma'am, that was really insightful, especially the part on the women parity. And yes, there is more scope.
We don't know actually that it impacted. We say that is a gendered impact of the pandemic. It impacted women more than men.
Right. Yeah, it's truly good figures and stats that we can take on. And always there's a scope of improvement for the government as well. And thank you so much, ma'am, for joining us today. It was a great pleasure to have you on our podcast.
Thank you, Tina, for having me here. My pleasure. Thank you.